So you look around the world and you see huge disparity in the human condition. You see some people that are desperately poor. You see others that are living in opulence. What is determining these differences in the human condition? Why are some societies working well compared to others? And why are some not working? The tools of economics, particularly the tools of mainline economics, can shed light on this. They can help us understand how does culture and institution shape the decisions that humans make. How can we change the incentives of policymakers through institutional change so that they can create better rules to help us live in peace and prosperity with one another? These ideas that were pioneered by Adam Smith, they're very much alive right now. There are people that are trying to apply these insights from the main line of economics to try to make our world a better place. Mainline economics is based on three propositions. The first is that humans have a natural desire to exchange with one another, truck, barter, and exchange, as Adam Smith said, and this exchange is a process of exchange. Number two is that this process of exchange is profoundly influenced by the culture and the institutions within which it takes place. You get very different outcomes based on different culture and different institutions. And three, these institutional differences are themselves the product of exchange, except it's exchange often in the political marketplace, not in the private marketplace. That's actually, I think, probably one of the strengths of mainline economics, is that its analytical focus is on the imperfections of institutions and how we can improve them and reduce frictions. So if you think about one version of mainstream economics, it's just to assume in this highly mathematized model of reality we call perfect competition that you have multiple buyers and multiple sellers and they're interacting in a frictionless environment in which property rights are perfectly protected, contracts are complete, information is complete, you have zero transactions costs. It's basically this antiseptic, really clean and elegant mathematical model, but it assumes away all the important and interesting characteristics of what makes societies work well or not work so well. Mainline economics really shines a light on those institutional differences to understand under what circumstances are property rights more or less complete, under what circumstances are transactions costs high or low, under what circumstances are the norms of culture such that people feel that they can interact with one another and trust one another and have lower transactions costs so that they can exchange with those with whom they stand to gain. Mainline economics is really focused on, in many ways, those important frictions that can stand between mutually beneficial exchange.
It's only through the existence of property, contract, and consent that individual pursuing their own self-interest can be led to promote the interests of society as a whole. It wasn't that anytime I pursue my self-interest, I'm going to generate a positive outcome. It was instead very institutionally contingent. And that basic idea runs from Adam Smith to John Baptiste de Say to John Stuart Mill into the early 20th century, including F.A. Hayek and James Buchanan and Ronald Coase and Doug North and Vernon Smith and Eleanor Ostrom. Mainstream economics is just whatever's currently fashionable at the time. If you think about it in a very simple sense, it's what's currently being considered the cutting edge of science, and everyone considers that to be the fashion. Sometimes the mainstream is the main line, and sometimes there's huge divorce between the mainstream and the main line. And when there's a huge divergence between those two things, it takes entrepreneurial action by individuals, such as the ones that I just mentioned that won the Nobel Prize, to pull economics back to its core teachings from Adam Smith to Vernon Smith.